7:25 right now, so I'm here to warm people up until then. But we got a very important sister that's going to come up now. There's Harriet Tubman. This sister name is not Harriet Tubman, but she is the Harriet Tubman to the Palestinian movement. And she's going to give us a real quick update on what's happening and what we should be doing and for the fight for our brothers and sisters, because we all one family against this corporate, it's not corporate America, against the corporations of the world, the few, you know, who is terrorizing all of us. Her name is Harriet Tubman. Well, I messed that up. And but look, this is a fighter, you know. Come on, sis. And I want people to know how much this means to this sister. She got a program that's going on in Poughkeepsie with M1 and a lot of other people. But she knew that this is important. It's important to her and to be here to share information and to be in solidarity with us tonight. So let's give this warrior woman a strong hand. All right.
Peace, everybody. Thank you so much for having me. Thanks to Ori for working so hard. He's been working for months on this, you know what I'm saying? And it's an honor to be here. I do have to run out as soon as I'm done, because we do have an event going on that's running in Poughkeepsie. We're making sure something's happening everywhere. So first of all, I just want to give you some numbers on Palestinian political prisoners. As of December 2015, there's 6,900 Palestinian political prisoners, 450 children under the age of 16 in Israeli jails. And when we say political prisoners, these are for reasons like administrative detention, which means if they want to investigate you, they put you in prison for 6 months and then they renew it after that 6 months. And there's people that have been in jail under administrative detention for over 30 years. So that's how many times they've renewed 6 months. There's kids that are getting 20 years for throwing stones at Israeli soldiers. That's a new law that Israel passed. So there's kids under the age of 16 going to jail for 20 years for throwing stones at soldiers that come and shoot them in their homes. Really, I'm here tonight because I want to say black and Palestinian solidarity. First of all, there's black Palestinians, which we're making a documentary on currently that we've been working on called Black in the Holy Land. But the black and Palestinian resistance and solidarity isn't nothing brand new. I know there's these new groups popping up, but we have to respect what our elders built. Because the Black Panthers believed the same thing that the PFLP, the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine, believed in. And they've been working together. They used to have conferences in Algeria. We ain't even having conferences here. You know what I'm saying? So they've been working together. It's nothing new. We did get a chance in 2009 to go on a convoy to Gaza with Charles Barron, Cynthia McKinney, and we visited families of political prisoners. And I think that's one of the important things, because it's not, of course, people in jail are having their lives stolen, but people out here that have family members here and in Palestine are also having their lives stolen and people stolen from them, people's kids, people's mothers, people's fathers. They're stealing people's lives. And when people come out, I know we celebrated our brother Sekou. It's like they're out, but is their freedom really freedom? You know what I'm saying? It's not really freedom. They stole their whole fucking life. Do you know what I'm saying? It's a victory, but it's the least that these motherfuckers can do to let people out. You know what I'm saying? And it's the same thing here and in Palestine, that when they realize that their violence and their intimidation and their brutality couldn't stop us. There's something inside of people who resist that there's nothing that can move us. You know what I'm saying? When I go to Palestine, I see little kids in front of tanks. They don't give a fuck. There's no weapons that scare them. There's no fear whatsoever. That's what a true revolutionary is, when you have no fear. And so, because they couldn't control us with violence, they went to plan B, which is just to put us in cages, right? I'm a little random, I'm sorry. I wanted to say that the reason I am here tonight is the solidarity with our MOVE comrades, who were supposedly citizens of this country, who fought for their freedom, the freedom of their people. They built their own communities. They taught their children love, self-sufficiency, independence. And they got bombed in their own community, in their own country. That shit is crazy. I speak to people every day that don't even know that people in Philadelphia got bombed by their own government. Enough is enough. I don't want to talk too much because I always say people talk too damn fucking much. I feel like we need to do more. Everybody has a role. I'm not saying everybody run out there with guns. Everybody ain't made for that. You know what I'm saying? But everybody has a role. Everybody has a part to play in this. You know what I'm saying? We need to support our political prisoners, and we need to support their families. Freedom to all of our brothers and sisters all across the world, from Palestine, Armenia, Philadelphia. That's all I can say. New York. Everywhere, everywhere. It's global. You know what I'm saying? And I'm with you. Thank you so much. I got to run out. Peace. Free them all.
Okay. On the move. That is a sister on the move, short on words, but she is really big in action. My brother Delbert Africa has called in from...
Del?
Del, are you here?
Hello. On the move. Can you hear me?
Go ahead, Del.
I can hear that fire coming through. All right.
You can't hear me.
You can't hear me.
Go ahead, Del.
On the move to everybody there, and I just want to say, long live revolution, long live John Africa's power that's got all these people united and fight this damn system. It's good to feel that vibration coming through this phone. On the move.
On the move, Del.
Hey,
I'm still up here, standing strong, just like the rest of the move, remaining move nine. And I'm feeling good knowing that people are out there fighting the system and not being duped into believing that this system is going to do right now. Because everything this system does is a lie, and I'm glad to see you people is exposing that lie for what it is and keep on fighting. And that keeps us going on strong.
Hey, Del, we here tonight in solidarity with Parole for the Women and their upcoming parole hearing. We got pictures of y'all posted. But tell the people about the women, Del, who don't know about them.
They just don't understand just how strong these women are and a foundation they have set for this organization. I'm talking about Janine, Debbie, Janet, and our beloved Merle that's been passed on have set examples for all, not only women, but all people who call themselves revolutionaries to follow. Oh, man, get off this phone. Can y'all still hear me through that? I'm talking about how these women, and I've said it in the past, have set a foundation not only for other women, but for anybody that calls themselves a revolutionary, a freedom fighter, to follow. Throughout isolation, throughout beatings by the guard, throughout years in the hole and all that, these women have stayed strong. They have stayed this conduct free despite all the government policy of trying to keep them down, and there's no reason whatsoever for anybody to, not fight for these women to be on the street. Oh, man, it is beautiful that these people are gathered together to fight for that. This system don't want move people on the street. They don't want, particularly, these move women to set the example that they're doing. Every time they come up for parole, it's always another excuse, always something else to hold them down. But I'm calling on everybody in the audience, and everybody in the audience knows, to start getting on the government. Start calling up Governor Wolf, emailing them, doing whatever. Flood the lines and tell them. They talk about saving money. By their own admission, it costs them $70,000 a year to keep us in these damn prisons.
Pennsylvania
go.
State Correctional Institution, Dallas. Just call the subject
of recording. All right, Del. We got a room full of people standing in solidarity tonight. We have a bunch of former political prisoners here, Del. We got the people's attorney, Lynn Stewart. Give her a shout. And her courageous warrior husband, Brother Ralph Pointier. Get him a shout, Del.
Yeah.
Tell them what you told them, Dell.
Amina Baraka.
We got Amina Baraka in the house, Dell. We got another former political prisoner, Laura Whitehorn, here too, Dell. We got your crew from the Anarchist Black Cross Federation. They here too. What you got to say to all of them, Dell? We got Suzanne Ross here. We got the crew from Workers' World Party. We got just the whole crew here tonight. Jericho, the Seeds of Wisdom. We got International Action Center, People's Organization for Progress, the campaign to bring Mumia home, Zaid Mohammed. We have Daniel McGowan, different people. What you got to say to everyone, Dell?
Thank you, and keep on moving. I don't care what kind of banner you're flying under, you got to stay on the move with it. Everybody knows standing water make you sick, but when it's moving, it's powerful, and y'all on the move. That's all I got to say about it. It feels good. It feels real good to know that this system ain't fooling everybody. Oh, man, it's a good feeling.
Got a room full of people. One of your comrades from your SCI Dallas, Russell Maroon Schultz, his whole family here tonight.
Yep.
His children, his grandbaby, give him a shout. Feeling you. Hey, Dell, your buddy Mary is here. She's in the back hanging out, working the food table. Give her a shout.
On the move. Handing out the food, huh?
She's smiling and waving to you. Your buddy Carlos is here. Your buddy sitting right here in the front row, Ann Lamb.
Yeah.
On the move, Ann. Yes, indeed. Sending you out a vibration of good hugs right through the phone.
Yep. Hey, Dell, we also got a sister here that's been on a 50-day hunger strike and all for Mumia and the people that is suffering from the hepatitis C inside the prisons. And all, she came here even on this 50-day hunger strike and all to show support and solidarity. On the move, sis, stand up.
Stand up, sis. Give her a shout, Dell.
Blessing and sending you that vibration of strength. Stay strong.
And,
oh, here,
okay. And Dell, the U.S. Parole Commission and the Parole Board, they striked again with Mutulu Shakur. He was supposed to be released this Wednesday, and they didn't release him. What you got to say on that?
This is another example of just how diabolical this damn system is. They know it's time for their brothers to come home, but they're scared. They're scared. Here's a government that talks all about justice, and John Africa has taught us, you can't depend on no justice from a system who has no justice to give. For years now, they've been harassing them, and that also is one of my comrades that I had the pleasure to meet and do time without at Long Polk Penitentiary. And it's time to let him go. Dr. Mutulu Shakur is a fighter for the people and needs to be out there amongst the people.
That's right,
so,
that's
once
right.
Again, this is a parole board. Federal government needs to be bombarded with letters, emails, or whatever. Send that brother home. Send him on home. They want to keep all these freedom fighters up here and label us terrorists. And everybody know the real terrorist is this government. Look at Flint, Michigan. You think them people ain't been terrorized with that dirty water that these fools put on them? This is what we're talking about. They the real terrorists. They the real thugs. And they just don't want the teachers out here. They don't want the revolutionaries out here to transform this system into, put it into the dirt where it belongs.
So. All right, Del. So we're going to wrap this up, Del. Leave everyone with some insight before we go.
I just want to let everybody know, revolution is a process. It's an individual process for each and every one of us to do what we can. It ain't necessary for everybody to be on the so-called front line, trade bullets or whatever. Revolution begins in the mind. And once you revolutionize yourself to quit believing in this system that has deceived you for years and years and your forefathers and foremothers before you, once you have taken that step, then you are a revolutionary and you on the right path. And I just want to say, keep on that same path. Keep moving, y'all. Keep moving. Stride the revolutionary path. On the move. Up here from the bowels of Dallas, I just want to say thank y'all and keep on rolling.
You hear him, Dale?
I hear it. I hear it and I feel it. I love every minute of it. They cut me off the phone anyway now. So y'all keep on doing what you're doing. I love y'all. On the move.
On the move, Dell. We love you here.
The caller has hung up.
Put it together for Brother Delbert Africa.
Okay, family. And I do mean that family. And because as I look out here, and I do see some new faces, and but the seasoned, long-time strugglers, and I see you still looking good, still looking strong as we age and continue to fight these motherfuckers as long as they stand it, we gonna stand. Okay, political prisoners. This is what this is also about. And my sisters are political prisoners. And who's been in jail for far too long. We have their children here, but we have the children of other political prisoners. And it is my honor to bring up to you the Russell Maroon Schultz family. The family, come on, y'all. Come on. Come on, warriors all. The children, the grandchildren, come on, spouses, come on, everybody on up here. We represent. Ori.
To be here. As a native of Philadelphia, the Moo family is indelibly imprinted on my mind. growing up watching the newscast from Powelton Village, also from Osage Avenue. I'm honored to be here as a woman, as a revolutionary, and a daughter of a revolutionary, should I say, and also to support the Move family. I'm just going to give a brief update on my dad's case. As you may or may not know, he was unjustly kept in solitary confinement for 22 years. This February will be 2 years that he's been released. So we are happy to be here to say that. Ultimately, of course, we want his freedom. And we got great news today from his lawyer that the judge denied the state's position, that they kept saying that they were doing what was been done for years. So the summary judgment has been denied. We will be heading to trial, and hopefully we will get a positive verdict, because clearly when my father came out, he was unable to walk up steps because he hadn't walked up steps in 22 years. So clearly the psychological damage that's done from solitary confinement, as well as the physical conditions that also exist, is always, you know, not necessarily known. My father didn't even know it till he couldn't walk up the steps. So we are looking for a positive outcome. You can keep up with us on RussellMaroonShows.com. We also put out a monthly newsletter every month with updates with regard to Maroon. And we're having a fashion show, Freedom Fundraiser, to celebrate the second year anniversary. It will be held in Philadelphia on February 27th on 52nd and Media. So please be there to support us for the upcoming trial. And again, please look for any updates on the RussellMaroonShows.com. And the fashion show. Hope to see you in Philadelphia. If not, we plan to do something in New York as well. All right. Take care. Peace. All right.
On the move, moving right along. Our next revolutionary speakers is Ben Ramos. Are you here, Ben? Who's dealing with the case of our brother Oscar Lopez. All right. Hey, Ben.
Hi, mommy.
All right.
Brothers and sisters, when I say freedom, you say now. Freedom. 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 Brothers and sisters, on behalf of the Boricua community and the Dominican community, welcome to Washington Heights. This is one of the most powerful neighborhoods we have. We have been fighting the denationalization of Haitians throughout all of these streets. We have been calling for the release of all political prisoners. Brothers and sisters, Oscar Lopez Rivera is doing well. He's a revolutionary Puerto Rican independence fighter that has been in jail for 34 years for fighting against the colonialization of our land, of our country, Puerto Rico. Brothers and sisters, on January 6th, he turned 73. For the past 34 years, he has been in jail. Almost half of his life he spent behind the bars for being a revolutionary. That same day, 8 million tweets were sent out demanding his release to President Obama. We were so inspired by that tweet campaign that we have dedicated the 29th of every month to Oscar. So we need to make that 8 million, 9 million, 10 million, 11 million, 20 million, 100 million. We need the support of our brothers and sisters to do that. But do not be fooled. We do not just do stuff on a computer. Our work is in the streets. We have letters and campaigns and palm cards that need to be signed. Because the only way we're going to free Oscar is by the people's movement. We need a mass movement that's not just Latino or Boricua or Dominican. It's got to be Black. It's got to be Asian. It's got to be Palestinian. It's got to be Middle Eastern. We have the power to free our prisoners. Hold the date of May 28th and 29th, that weekend. We are doing 2 days of solidarity for Oscar because May 29th will be the 35th anniversary of his arrest. We're gonna be doing something at 26 Federal Plaza and then doing something in the community. So we need people rallying there. We need a Mumia contingent. We need a Move 9 contingent. We need a Leonard Peltier contingent. We need everyone coming out. Brothers and sisters, to end, I wanna end with prisoner of conscience, Ana Belén Montes. She's a Puerto Rican sister. Most of you don't know who she is, but now we are working to educate the communities because she is a woman that is in jail because she decided to follow her conscience and not the law. For many years, she was an agent of the US government spying on Cuba, amassing information on the Cuban Revolution. She did this for 16 years and was so disgusted with herself and disgusted with that action that she flipped the script and started sharing US secrets with Cuba. On February 28th, she's gonna be turning 59. We are going to be doing a new campaign demanding her release. She is in one of the most horrible prisons in the United States. She's in a psychiatric ward where she is not allowed to talk to people, receive mail, read the newspaper, watch TV. She can only talk to prison guards and her lawyers and families. She is separated from people to try to destroy who she is, to break her down psychologically. Brothers and sisters, in March, we are planning a Women's Day activity dedicated to her to educate the community about who she is. We need you to come out. She can't receive letters, but that night we're gonna be writing letters to Obama demanding her release. So brothers and sisters, when I say freedom, you say now. Freedom!
Yeah.
Freedom!
Yeah.
Freedom!
Yeah.
Let's free them all.
Damn, this is pleasurable. And I hope everybody is writing the information down. If you don't, everybody have information at their tables. But I'm getting ready to introduce a sister, warrior, word assassin, the wife of Amiri Baraka. Yes, yes, and I'm telling you, she is a word assassin. She is poetry in motion. She's a grandmother. She's a mother. I'm saying she's a widow at this time, but she's a warrior woman of all things, a noted one, an unapologetic one. She will lay your ass out no matter where you are when you're wrong. She ain't got no problem with it. She can lay it out in poetry. She can lay it out any kind of way there is. If anybody can call a motherfucker more than I can, excuse me. It's this sister here, Amina Baraka, the unapologetic warrior with class.
This is embarrassing. This is embarrassing. I'm standing before people who have given their lives and their children's life. This is embarrassing. No, when I say that, and I'm serious about that, is that everybody in this audience have given much more than I will ever be able to give. Or my husband, who has gone. But you have given your lives and your children's lives, and our people are still in prison. And we've got to do something. And I love what everybody has said. The people united will never be defeated. Black, Latin, Asian, white, and get it right. And as a poem, it's time to free the Move 9. I got a right to sing the blues. I got a right to feel low down. I got a right to hang down. down by the river, 'cause the river flows. 'Cause this old racist imperialist state keeps trying to bring the whole world down. Yeah, I got a right. I got a right to sing the blues. I wanna write blues lines about workers dying of black lung, brown lung, overworked, underpaid, blown up, burnt fingers cut off, and wrecked in wretched lives in general. I got a right to sing the blues. I wanna sing songs that weep the pain and horror of monopoly capitalism. Words that paint imperialism as the world's enemy, 'cause it is. I gotta write. I wanna write blues lines about workers that led the strike, the ones that spoke out, the ones that demonstrated against the death penalty. I gotta write to sing the blues. The ones that fight racism and anti-Semitism, the ones for Palestinian liberation, the ones that seek peace in the Middle East. Oh, I got a right to sing the blues. I got a right to feel low down. I want to pass out leaflets. This is for the people who pass out leaflets to free the Caribbean, Latin America, and protect Cuba. I got a right to sing the blues. The workers that support the Irish, Asian, African revolutions, the ones that lead the peace movement, the ones that stand up for working class women, gay rights, and religious freedom. Oh, I got a right to sing the blues, and I'm gonna sing them. All right. I wanna celebrate all of them in a lyrical way, in a way they will like. Yeah, I wanna be a people's poet. I wanna write fire lines. I wanna sing the blues that free us all, that will catch on to the bourgeoisie's hoods, burn the cover off their lies, expose them as the first and real criminals. I wanna write words that will do some good, that will unite the international working class, something that will do good for black people and all people and everybody and everyone that is oppressed. Oh, I wanna sing the blues. I wanna be a poet of the people. Use my words to accompany the struggle against imperialism, 'cause that's the only way I can be a people's poet and do some real good, 'cause I know how to sing the blues. And I'm gonna sing the blues until everybody in prison who ain't supposed to be there get out and get free. And this goes to all of y'all. It's time to free the move now. And I'm gonna sing the blues. Thank you.
Wow. Hey. All right.
Now, the next person to come to the microphone is a political prisoner, an unapologetic political prisoner. She gave him hell before she went in, gave him the blues while she was in there, turned that prison inside, outside, and every other kind of side. And she's on the street doing the exact same thing. She was one of them people that went to jail and they scared her with all their torture and terrorism that they did to her before she went, and then after she went, you know, came out. I'm talking about Laura Whitehorn, a revolutionary without a pause. Come on, Laura, let them know what you've been doing.
Unfortunately, I am in the middle of a second bout of a respiratory thing, so I'm not going to be that fiery like you were promised. So she was introducing someone else. I just want to say it is a huge honor to be asked to speak here. I'm so glad to be here. And I just want to say that solidarity is the most necessary human experience and feeling that there is. More than any other, it is love, it is energy, it is nurture, it is everything. Standing together. A lot of us in this room have different ideas about what the strategy is for this and that, but we are together because we are all put together on a couple of things. One is that oppressed people have a right to fight for their freedom, and the oppressor does not have the right to tell them how they can fight for their freedom. That's number one. The second thing is that we live in a colonialist, a white settler colony. And we have unity with people in Palestine who also live in a white settler colony, just as we did with the people of South Africa who lived in a white settler colony. So when we're fighting the state, we are doing that internationally. We know that it is the final kind of knell of the state, the not death knell, but the bang, bang on your head, that our political prisoners have to ask for parole at all. That there was a revolutionary movement that people were part of. It was attacked on all fronts, not just COINTELPRO. Sometimes we talk too much about just COINTELPRO. And there is now the beginning of a new movement that looks like that, but we don't have it yet. And so our people are still in the hands of the state, and we have to use the state's stupid tools, the parole board, to get out. And so people have to go through processes that are extremely painful, and their families are waiting to hear. I work in something called Release Aging People in Prison, which encompasses the political prisoners, and we started because we saw that they were part of a large group of people. In New York State, it's over 9,500 people who are over the age of 50, and it's growing all the time. So we have allies. We have some people who are also willing. We are starting to call out the PBA. There's a couple of articles on the rap table back there that have been in the Albany papers by people that you all know and love that are talking about the influence of the police on the parole process. That is exactly the same thing that our MOVE sisters and brothers are up against. So we are saying free them all. We support their parole. When people are asked to write letters for parole, for people for parole, please do it. Even, I can tell you, I never went for parole because I just knew I wouldn't get it at that point, and I maxed out. But I did go for bail a few times. I never got it. And every time, you know, you go back to your cell, they tell you, you know, the hell with you, stay in prison. But you look at those letters that people have written for you, and it's like you feel the solidarity. So please do it. Keep fighting. Do something all the time. We just all just need to keep doing it until we get it right and we get our freedom fighters out and free the MOVE 9, free all political prisoners, and Matu will get parole because we are all going to fight for it really hard. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Laura. And, you know, I want to thank not only Laura for coming and, you know, she's, you know, not feeling well, throat, she talking about, you know, she ain't fire. I'm telling you, anytime you leave your homes, come up to this front line, express solidarity, the sister was fire. Okay, Laura. Okay, I gotta find where I'm at on this list, okay? I'm introducing the brother from Press TV. And if you want, I'm trying to find his name on here. Help me. Brother Caleb Marpet from Press TV. We always want to see something in alternative to the BS that we be seeing on the media. And this brother here from Press TV, if you've never seen it, get his card and I'll get the information so that he can be constantly sending information to you. And if you need to be on his TV, and he accommodates. Revolution on the move. The revolutionary newsman, Brother Taylor.
Wow. When I got the message from Ori that I was invited to come here tonight and give a presentation, I was just speechless. I didn't know quite what to do. And when I read that both Pam and Ramona Africa were going to be here to speak, I couldn't hold myself back. I had to bring a gift. Pam and Ramona Africa, can you come up here? I had to bring a gift. I got this for you, for both of you. I got one for each of you.
Oh.
And this is an old poster. And I guess for those of you who can't read, it says, "Remember, we are in here for you, are out here for us."
That's right.
There's no two people that better exemplify the spirit, you know, that is expressed on this poster than these two individuals.
Gosh. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I mean, to go through so much, to be part of a chosen family of dedicated activists in Philadelphia, to see members of your family locked up and gunned down and so ruthlessly persecuted, but to keep fighting every day, to keep raising your head up high and demanding justice, this takes a strength of character that so many of us can only really aspire to have. And this isn't a new work of art. It's a reprint of a poster that was circulated about 100 years ago. At the top of the poster, it actually says, "Fellow Workers," because it was put out by the Industrial Workers of the World, a radical labor union 100 years ago, whose members were locked in prison for speaking up and fighting for justice. Now, I guess I have to say this. There's some people here who know me, and they know I can be a little bit of a firebrand. I don't always say things the way people want me to or do things exactly the way people have always done them. But there's one rule that I think that, you know, that we can take from the last generation of activists, and they got it from the previous generation of activists, and they got it from the last generation of activists. It's one of the most important rules for anyone to learn when they come into the movement. And that's that if at any point the state comes for somebody who's fighting against capitalism or fighting against racism or fighting against the unjust wars or fighting for equality, if the powers that be come for anyone in our movement, all of us have a duty to do everything in our power to win their freedom and bring them home. Doesn't matter what party you're in, doesn't matter what tactical decisions you've made, doesn't matter what books you read or what arguments or disagreements you've had in the past, doesn't matter if you're an anarchist or a pan-Africanist or a Trotskyist or a Stalinist or an anthropologist or an orthodontist, whatever you are, if the state comes for you and you're a fighter, we all have a duty to be on your side. We have a duty to stand for the people in our movement, and we have to send a message. And the message has got to be, if for any reason they come for one of us, they're going to have to deal with all of us! I got to tell you, last May I was sitting in a hotel lobby on the other side of the world in Tehran, and I was talking to some Iranian journalists, and they said to me, you know, "Mr. Maupin, we've seen you've done a few stories about this political prisoner, Mr. Mumia Abu-Jamal. And we were hoping you could tell us, when was it that he converted to Islam?" And I had to specify, I had to say, "Well, Mumia Abu-Jamal is not really a Muslim." I said, "Well, what are his religious beliefs?" And so there, sitting in this hotel lobby, I had to kind of stutter and tell a story I really don't know well enough, the story of the MOVE organization. I had to tell them who John Africa was. And after I spoke to these reporters, I mean, they were just kind of blown away by what I was saying. And They had to learn more, because everything we do has global implications. Everything we do here in the U.S. And they were very, very interested to learn about the truth about what goes on here in the United States and what's done by a government that is constantly attacking and beating down other governments in the name of human rights while at the same time persecuting and murdering people here at home. Now, this small group of bankers and billionaires that run the world, they're very powerful. They've got drones, they've got tanks, they've got bombs, they've even got nuclear weapons. But there's one weapon that they've got in their arsenal, which I would say is probably even more deadly than all the other ones combined. I brought it with me here tonight. It's the press. The fact that we're here tonight, even though it's freezing cold, even though it's a Friday night, we could be out partying or we could be at home all cozy and warm, the fact that we're here shows the power of alternative media. It shows that sometimes those who speak the truth can shout louder than the billion-dollar megaphones of the rich and powerful. And it also shows that the bravery, the sacrifice, and the dedication given over the years by people like Pam and Ramona Africa, it has not gone to waste. All the MOVE political prisoners must be free, and all political prisoners must be free. I'll end just by saying this. Every single one of us has a voice, but it's up to us to choose how we use it. It's very easy to echo the latest trendy thing you've read in the New York Times, but true revolutionaries, the ones who go down in history, those who are brave enough and bold enough, they're the ones who are remembered. They're the ones who are brave enough and bold enough to say the most unpopular things and to stand for the most demonized and slandered people, even when it's very hard to do. So I guess, you know, it's just an honor to be invited here, and I guess I'll just end with the words from the poster. They are in here for us, and we must be out here for them.
The spirit of revolution is in here tonight. All right, you can do that. Okay, he's introducing a great friend of mine.
All right, first put it together for Brother Caleb Morpins. Press TV. Truthful media out here tonight. Thank you, Brother Caleb. All right. We couldn't be in Harlem without having this brother here tonight. This brother's a fixture in the community. Iman Al Haj Talib Abdur-Rashid. Hold on. Let's tell you about this brother. He is the religious and spiritual leader, Iman, of the Mosque of Islamic Brotherhood Incorporated, the Mosque, which will be 49 years old in 2 months, is located in Harlem, New York City, is the institutional heir of the Muslim Mosque Incorporated, founded by the late El Haj Malik El Shabazz, Malcolm X, in 1964. Iman Abdur-Rashid is also a president emeritus of the Islamic Leadership Council of the Metropolitan New York. Currently, he is its newly appointed Special Representative for Restorative Justice, Civil and Human Rights. Nationally, he serves as the Vice President of the Muslim Alliance in North America. The Iman served on the Board of Directors for the Malcolm X and Dr. Betty Shabazz Educational and Memorial Center for the past 10 years and is now on its advisory board. Put your hands together for Brother Iman Al-Haj Talib Abdur-Rashid.
Peace be unto you all. Salaam alaikum. On the move. On behalf of the men and women, younger generation and elders of the Mosque of Islamic Brotherhood, and also of the Muslim Alliance in North America, I want to express my thanks to the organizers of this extremely important event. We appreciate this opportunity to express our solidarity with all of you, with the still incarcerated members of MOVE generally, and Janet, Janine, and Debbie Africa in particular, and indeed with Mumia Abu-Jamal, Imam Jamil Abdullah Al-Amin, Leonard Peltier, and all authentic political prisoners in the prisons of America and the world. For us as Muslims, justice is a sacred principle, a sacred right. As it is written in the Quran, the word of your Lord finds its fulfillment in truth and justice. We also see fighting injustice as a sacred duty. As Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said that Almighty God Allah has said, O my servants, I have forbidden oppression and injustice for myself, and I have made it forbidden amongst you, so do not oppress one another. So this is the frame for my brief comments tonight, because it is clear to all of us that the continued incarceration of our brothers and sisters from MOVE after more than three decades is an injustice that must be opposed. Their freedom must be prayed for, worked for, and acted upon concretely. And we of the Muslim community who understand this are committed to truth, freedom, and justice for all political prisoners, for ourselves, our people, and all people. As I said, I only have a relative few minutes because of the esteemed lineup of activist leaders we have tonight. That's why I'm reading my comments, because I want to keep it tight. So I only want to make three points and then make way for the next speaker. My intention in outlining these three points is to speak to why acting for justice for Janet, Janine, and Debbie Africa is our common sacred duty. Number one, first, because they are really political prisoners.
That's right.
The official position of the United States government is that there are no political prisoners in America, only people who commit crimes. Every time I hear that, it makes the hair on my head stand up, and as you can see that, you know what I mean? Because when I always remember running away from slavery was a crime. Teaching people of African descent was a crime. The jails and prisons of America are filled with 2.5 million people allegedly because they committed crimes. But Uncle Sam says there are no political prisoners in America. But we who are enlightened and conscious in the 21st century, we know better than that. Generally speaking, a political prisoner is a person who is incarcerated because of their political views. Uncle Sam claims that doesn't happen in the U.S. We don't lock people up because of their views, he says. But during this, the 51st Memorial Month of the martyrdom of our brother and leader, El-Hajj Malik El-Shabazz Malcolm X, we know that we have to look at matters with human rights eyes and not just American-centered civil rights eyes. So in October, 4 years ago, October 2012, the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe became the first major intergovernmental organization to approve concrete criteria for what defines a political prisoner. A political prisoner, according to their definition, is a prisoner who, male or female, who meets one of the following criteria. Number one, the detention of them violates basic guarantees in the European Convention on Human Rights, particularly freedom of thought, conscience, and religion, freedom of expression, it sounds kind of familiar, and information, and freedom of assembly and association. The detention of a political prisoner is imposed for purely political reasons. The length or conditions of detention are out of proportion to the offense. He or she is detained in a discriminatory manner as opposed to other people. The detention is the result of judicial proceedings that are clearly unfair and unjust and connected with the political motives of authorities. Well, we don't live in Europe, Uncle Sam says, even as he often avoids the signing of such international human rights documents, while at the same time talking about human rights violations everywhere else in the world but here. But Amnesty International, who has offices in America last time I looked, Amnesty International as well uses the term political prisoner to describe any prisoner whose case has a political element, either in the motivation of the prisoner's act, the act itself, or the motivation of the authorities in their response. I repeat, Janet, Janine, and Debbie Africa are political prisoners. And those of us who stand for truth and justice, we must continue to press forward with those concrete actions of political organization that will hold the United States of America to the same standard of accountability as all other countries in the world. Secondly, the MOVE sisters are women. And the forces of repression in America have always targeted both women and men who struggle against injustice. Women are human beings entitled to justice, but they receive injustice in America, especially when they are black. Just ask 7-year-old Ayanna Stanley Jones, or 69-year-old Eleanor Bumpus, or Tanisha Anderson, or Tarika Wilson, or Rakia Boyd, or Sandra Bland. The only problem is that we can't ask them because they're dead. And they're dead as the result of police use of excessive and deadly force, in spite of the fact that they were women or little girls. While coverage of so-called mass incarceration in America focuses appropriately on men, some of you know my assistant imam at the mosque, Brother Mikhail DeVoe. He told me just today, he says, I'm going to stop calling it mass incarceration, he said. I'm going to start calling it hyper-incarceration. So coverage on the hyper-incarceration in America focuses appropriately on men. We should be aware, however, that as our brother, writer, blogger, Jamal Hadler, he wrote, and I quote, as the number of women incarcerated has increased by 800% over the last three decades, women of color have been disproportionately represented. While the number of women incarcerated is relatively low, in comparison to the men. The racial and ethnic disparities are startling. African American women are 3 times more likely than white women to be incarcerated, while Latinas, Spanish-speaking women, are 69% more likely than white women to be incarcerated. As activists, we must continue to struggle for radical transformation of the criminal injustice system. And we must do so against this system that has victimized women like our sister. And thirdly and lastly, the trial, sentencing, and incarceration of all of the members of the MOVE organization. You know, it really, it's amazing. You know, MOVE organization was an organization dedicated to environmental justice. And here we live in a country where you have armed white supremacists who go and take over federal land at gunpoint, and everybody sits around and drink coffee and twiddle their thumbs, wait 40 days for the last person to come out. Whereas our people who were doing nothing more than living a different lifestyle, and I might add an environmental friendly lifestyle, become subject to repression and violence and discrimination and trumped up charges and all of this sort of thing, leading to the worst example of a domestic bombing of civilians since Black Wall Street. You feel me? So considering the trial, sentencing, and incarceration of the MOVE members was unjust to begin with, considering the political atmosphere and discriminatory, repressive, and fascistic tactics of the Philadelphia Police Department, those of us who are old enough to remember, under the infamous leadership of Police Commissioner Frank Rizzo, who eventually became Philly's mayor, the incarceration of the MOVE members was itself an act of injustice. And as of itself, we activists must continue to struggle for police reform and accountability. So those are my 3 points. Those are my 3 points, and these are points of justification and motivation for the elimination of injustice. And we pray to Almighty Allah that He will free this sister who's on the line, who's coming in, and free all political prisoners. Thank you very much. Peace be unto you all. Salam alaikum.
Okay. My sister Janine Africa is on the phone just to say a little.
Go ahead and talk to them, Janine. You can hear everything?
Yeah, I can hear that.
New York City crowd is loving you tonight.
I can't hear you.
Can you hear us now?
Yeah.
I said the New York City crowd is loving you tonight.
All right, now long live John African, on the move to everybody here.
We got a full crowd in here tonight. We got a lot of former political prisoners here, Janine. Laura Whitehorn is here.
Wow, all right now.
We got Sister Lynn Stewart is here.
All right now.
We got Daniel McGowan, another former political prisoner.
We got all right now.
A bunch of New York supporters here. Suzanne Ross is right here sitting up front.
It's been there for years.
That's right. Johanna Fernandez is here.
Y'all on the move.
And your buddy Ann Lamb is here.
Who?
Ann Lamb.
Oh, hi, Ann. Loyal for years.
Okay, and we got old Margie, Odette, who just came up from seeing you. She in the house.
I can't hear you too good, Ori.
Okay, can you hear us now?
Yeah.
Okay, we got Margie, who just came up to visit you in December. She's sitting here front row.
Who did you say?
Margie. Odette.
I can't hear you. Hold on. Okay. I know it's hard, but it's like, y'all, you sound muffled and it's breaking up, so bear with me.
Okay, well, nah, just talk to the crowd. We got a room full of people. Just talk to them. They came out to support parole for y'all tonight, so let them know.
All right, now, listen, for everybody, we appreciate all the support. We're grateful for it because we know how much hard work it is to fight this system. We're not under any illusions of what this system intends to do to move, what they've been trying to do to move since the above ground chapter moved service in Philadelphia in the 70s. They can talk all the talk they want, but they want to kill move people. They want to exterminate us because we tell the truth. The only reason why we're still in these jails, and y'all know it, they're supposed to let us out. We should have never been locked up. But since we've been seeing parole...
Pennsylvania State Correctional Institution, Cambridge Spring. This call is subject to recording and monitoring.
But since we've been seeing parole in 2008, they just hitting us because their goal, what they're hoping, is that we get all weak and give up. And if we're not going to do that, then they intend to keep us in here till we die. And we're saying to everybody, don't accept that. It is time that people stood up to this system and let them know that they are not tolerating this corruption, these crimes against people that have the heart to stand up to them, because that's all this is about. Anybody that has the heart to stand up to this system, they want to crush them, kill them, get rid of them. And that's what they're trying to do to move. But move is saying, no way, they're not getting rid of us. We're not getting weak. We're not getting old. We're not going to die out. We're not going to give up. So we're going to keep fighting, and we hope y'all keep fighting too, because eventually they're going to have to get up.
Okay, they feeling your energy.
I just can't hear, so I'm just going to talk until my phone time is up, because I can't hear nothing that Ori's saying. But, you know, it's just evident what's happening with this system. You know, I mean, I ain't got to tell y'all, people that just got from behind these bars, you know what it's like. People whose families support them all these years know what it's like. You don't have to commit a crime to come to jail. All you got to do is be accessible, and the police will do the rest, and this government will back them up and let them do their dirty work to try to get rid of everybody that's taking a stand. And that's all this is about, and people got to remember that. And don't ever, ever get discouraged because it seemed like we're not making no headway. Don't ever get discouraged, because we are. The very fact that these people don't want to let us out of jail is letting y'all know that y'all are being heard. We are being heard. They still see us as small.
Pennsylvania State Correctional Institution, Cambridge Spring. This call is subject to recording and monitoring.
And they still see us as a threat to their crimes, because if they felt like move was insignificant and that y'all were insignificant, they would have been let us out of jail, because they wouldn't be fearing us, fearing y'all, fearing anything. So don't get discouraged. They are very aware of the strength, the unity in the people, and they are very aware of this revolution. And that's why they fight so hard to keep us in here, because they don't want us to be the vanguard out there in this revolution, because they can't stop it. The seed of the revolution has been planted. They can't stop nothing. They just don't want us to get out there and everybody come together, unite, and that revolution take all full force. That's all this is about. So never get discouraged, because we are being effective.
Right.
One other thing that I just want people to know, no matter what's going on, no matter how, you know, people have different agendas, whatever. It's important for everybody to stay united, stay one force against this system. Don't let differences tear you apart, divert you from the cause, because that's another tactic that this government uses to keep everybody separated and going their separate ways. Stay united no matter what. You don't have to agree with what somebody else is saying or doing. You just have to agree to stop this system and to free these political prisoners, and that's all that matters. So don't let differences interfere. And remember that. When it comes up, just remember that's a tactic that this system uses. Everybody has to stay united. Unity is the biggest threat to this system. So stay united. Stay with your mind on one course. And I'm telling you, John F. has told us, this system is buckling at the knees. So just remember that. Everybody remember that. You want, it's time to get us out of these places. And the only way you're going to be able to do it is if you stay one force united. So keep that in mind. Y'all want us home? We got to work together to get that done.
All right.
It really feels good, and I love it because everything is just growing. This revolution is picking up pace. The support, the unity is just getting so strong and growing so big that look at that and let that encourage you and motivate you and see that they ain't stopped nothing. Everything that they have tried to do over the years to stop this revolution has failed. It has failed, and it's going to keep failing. And soon, people are going to see a result and see all the reward for all the hard work y'all doing. Just stay the course. Don't give up. Just like people did with slavery. They didn't give up, and it looked like they would never get out of that bondage. But they kept on going. They kept on fighting, no matter what. And that's how we got to do now, because for real, this is just showing us that slavery never ended, crystallized, and we got to keep fighting just like our ancestors did to get free. We got to keep fighting so we can get free too, because ain't nobody free. This system got its foot on everybody's neck. Ain't nobody out there satisfied. Ain't nobody out there feeling like they got the freedom to say what they want to say, live the way they want to live. So we got to fight for that freedom. In here and out there. So just keep that in mind and just keep going, everybody. Just keep going no matter what. The revolution is here, and don't ever let nobody tell you it's not. I'm sorry I can't hear y'all, but I can feel that support, even though I can't hear too good on this phone. And I'm telling you, I want to say it once again, thank you all for everything y'all are doing to fight to get us out of these prisons, to help our family who's been fighting for us from day one. Never slowed down, never gave up. You know, we got so much support, so much love, that we can't help but be strong on this activity. And y'all can trust in that. We are going to stay strong no matter what. So thank you all for everything.
On the move. My sister Janine and the rest of the move women. Right. I just want to say, to give a little background on my sister Janine. When I first met her, and oh, she's still on? Oh, okay. So when I first met Janine, and all, she was a young mother, and with a young baby. Juju was his name. And when I met her and the other move women before I got in move. And her three-week-old baby, Life Africa, was crushed to death in front of our headquarters. on a police terroristic raid to try to stop the MOVE organization from speaking. Our men, their arms was broke. A lot of people were beat up that night, and because we continued to demonstrate. Some years later, they dropped a bomb, killing Janine and Phil Africa's son in the bombing. And they both continued to fight because they understand that to give up is to lose. And through the teachings of John Africa, who kept them strong and committed, as you heard today, then on January the 10th, I think it was, 10th is when Phil was murdered inside the prison, and I say murdered, and because when Phil went into the prison, he was healthy, he was strong, he was kidnapped, and at gunpoint, and where the government threw hand grenades into the house. It was a military move, and I'm not talking about 1985 when they dropped a bomb on a house killing 11 men, women, and children. I'm talking about the fear that they had a MOVE in 1978. And when they came there, and a police officer by the name of James Ramp was murdered by their cops. It's evident, the proof is there. But you know, just a little background into the strength and all that the sister that you just heard and the other two sisters that's in prison with her, you know, have. It's the teachings of John Africa that keeps every last one of us, because what you see in myself and Ramona and other MOVE people on the street is what people see inside the prisons. And you know, things that used to go on inside the prisons don't go on inside the prisons anymore. And because John Africa taught MOVE the meaning of consistency. And you know, in order to break this government, to break them down, and it has been done over the years, and is that you gotta stay consistent, persistent, and stay on the MOVE, fighting these people no matter where you're at. So the next person I want to introduce, and I'm going to bring this dynamic trio up, and is Lynn Stewart, Ralph, and Betty Davis. When Lynn was in jail, I'm telling you, the fight to bring Lynn home was a battle that you'll never ever forget. So the two warriors behind the battle, and here she is. Revolution do work. Consistency. Is that what we're talking about? We're talking. That's right.
If you didn't know it before, you should know now. We're here tonight to celebrate the Africa family. And to praise them, the martyrs of the Africa family, and the heroes and sheroes, some of which are still behind the bars. And, of course, to bring them home. Yes. The Africas are unique among our political prisoners. They're not the same as all the others, in a very different way. Because under the wise and brilliant tutelage, teaching of John Africa, they determined to lead new lives, completely changed lives, environmentally favorite lives, as a family. And as such, they repudiated the values of the corporate, of the capitalist, of the white system. There was no bling. There was nothing artificial about them or their children. They did not exploit anyone. Instead, they had commitment to each other and to all of us. And so, in that search for freedom, of course, and others have searched for freedom as well by forming communes and living apart, but they were different because they were Africa. And as the name implies, they were emphatically black. And that was intolerable to the government, all the governments, name whichever level you want. Intolerable. And so they first tried to shoot them down. And that was the firefight that Pam was just talking about. And that was the firefight that resulted in them arresting most of the folks who are still in jail, and which a judge once remarked, I don't know who shot the cop. Of course he doesn't, because it was friendly fire, and they're never going to admit that. But we're going to keep these people locked up because they scare us. Because their sincerity and their truth, that frightens us. And so today it is up to us. We are the new army. We have to liberate the Africans and all the other political prisoners. Someone remarked a minute ago that it's the 51st anniversary of Malcolm, who died right here on this floor, this sacred place. I also would just like to remind you, when we're thinking about who to glorify and who to think about in this year, it's also the 30th anniversary of Larry Davis. And unlike most of us in this room, Larry Davis was not political, but he did the most political thing by standing up for himself and fighting back. And I have to say, that's not an original line. There's a reporter, Ralph, help me with the name.
Reporter?
From Amsterdam News that said Larry Davis was not political, but he did the most political act of all.
Waters.
Okay, Waters.
Malachi Waters.
Is writing an article for the New Amsterdam about Larry. But we should think about that, because that decision, when that jury acquitted him, it was electric in the city. It brought out all the bourgeois Negroes who said things like, you can't use self-defense against the cops. Hello? So, I don't want to take more time. We have some more wonderful, wonderful speakers who will talk to you. I am going to read you a poem, because you know that's my thing. I love poetry. It's what kept me alive and sustained me, along with a couple of other folks while I was in prison. A couple of other folks, all of whom are sitting in the audience as well. But I'm going to read you a poem by a newfound friend who I really didn't know much about until a couple of years ago, Mango Netuilango. And he's a great poet, and he's been 45 years in jail in Nebraska. So you know he's not getting a whole lot of visits. He's an ex-Panther. There is going to be a parole hearing in November. This year is full of parole hearings. You know, write a form letter if you have to, but get letters out for these folks, for heaven's sakes. Lennox Hines is coming out of retirement to represent him. So let's do it. Let's get these letters out. Let's show that there is a group out here that the government has to be more afraid of than they are of the groups that want to keep them in. More afraid of us than of them. And I do want to alert everybody to a demo, which I think is still going forward on the 16th, against, yes, 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 the PBA. The PBA is going to demonstrate to protest. It's Beyonce, is that who it was? Yes, Beyonce. I'm a different era. I'm Nina Simone and Billie Holiday. Come on. But they're protesting Beyonce's glorification of the Black Panthers in her Super Bowl. And I'm being handed a leaflet even. It's on Tuesday, February 16th, and we're going to gather outside St. Patrick's Cathedral. Oh, this is a relief. The original thing I saw said 8 a.m. This is 1 p.m. 51st Street and 5th Avenue. We're going to march to NFL headquarters, which is where the PBA is slated to demonstrate against the Black Panthers. They never miss an opportunity, and by God, we're not going to miss this one either. Be out there. So I'm going to read you a poem. I'm going to read just part of it. It's kind of long. And it's really about who is the real enemy and not to be led astray by not false enemies, but with it has to do with the fight against the Confederate flag. And it talks about what flag we should really fight against. To have more dirt kicked in our faces in the twilight's endless gleaming of shattered hopes, which in truth this flag of Bill Clinton and Strom Thurmond represents, this old glory in the here and now, where it is not Confederate flags sewn on the shirts of the cops who commit their brutalities on the streets of America, not Confederate flags flying in front of the courts that dispense to us injustice with such consistent regularity, not Confederate flags in the classrooms of the schools committing the menticide of our children, not Confederate flags on the grounds of banks with us and them lending policies by which we are them who systematically can't get what others can. Not Confederate flags flapping from the poles of corporate headquarters where CEOs decide that the communities where we live are prime locations for toxic waste dumps, chemical refineries, Flint. Not in the shadow of the Confederate flag do the hearses cruise and the cruisers creep, their sirens like hyenas' howls, their drivers on the prowl to catch the crimes in progress of driving while black, walking while black, just chilling while black, fitting the general description of, to catch the optical illusions of wallets that look like guns. Not in the shadow of the Confederate flag do these and other kinds and shapes of murder run and deceptions big and small, but in the shadow of the stars and stripes that we sing an anthem and pledge allegiance as if its liberty and justice for all included us. Remember the enemy. Let's get out there. Let's keep our fight up. We can do it. We are many. They are few. Thank you.
And in the words of Jaleel Montague, who is in prison, he asked me to have you repeat, "Remember, we are our own liberators." Let's hear it. We are our own liberators. Thank you.
Put it together for a dynamic duo. And it's just not even a dynamic duo, but the triple threat. Lynn, Ralph, and Sister Betty. Okay, so we moving right along. Our next speaker, we got a bio, because it's a powerful sister. Zulu Queen Binu Mott is both the founder and president of the Bronx, New York-based Universal Zulu Nation, Wisdom Born Phoenix Queens Chapter Number 29. A project coordinator for the Zulu Nation Department of Community Affairs. She is also a single parent, activist, and an independent student of Africana Studies. Queen Binu received her BA in Sociology at the City University of New York's Lehman College and is currently enrolled in the CUNY Graduate Center's Masters of Arts and Liberal Studies program, where she is engaged in graduate research on hip-hop pedagogy while on a track to a PhD in the urban education. Put it together for our next speaker, Sister Zulu Queen Binu Mott.
Well, it's a lot of people here, yeah. Peace, family. First, I would like to say on behalf of the Universal Zulu Nation, thank you for having us here today. It is both an honor and a privilege to be here among everybody, so thank you for having us. Before I came here tonight, I was very unsure of what I was going to say. I was on the bus, and then something made me look up James Baldwin's speech, Baldwin's Nigger. There was a line from it that I believe it is safe to say will speak to all of our own individual experiences, as well as our collective, historical, cultural, social, and political experiences as well. What one does realize is that when you try to stand up and look the world in the face like you had a right to be here, what you do when you do that without knowing that this is the result of it, you have attacked the entire power structure of the Western world. We are here tonight because the brothers and sisters of MOVE stood up and looked the world in the face and said we have the right to be here. We have the right to live our lives according to the principles of life, natural law, self-defense, and justice being based on what is right and what is wrong rather than what is legal. We have the right to instill in our children that revolutionary spirit so that they do not grow to pull away from the community, but builds in the community, for the community, creating strong, nurturing, revolutionary families. We have the right to be free from persecution by the system. And for the duration of the struggle for Black liberation, we will create, mold, and develop righteous leaders who will continue to stand up and face this world and say we have the right to be here. On August 8, 1978, our MOVE family learned firsthand, as did and do so many of our freedom fighters, the meaning of Baldwin's words. They learned firsthand the sacrifices that are made when we choose to stand up, that we risk losing not only our own individual lives and freedom, but those of our families, including our most precious gifts that we give to this world, our children. We are here in solidarity to shed light on our sisters, our queens, Debbie Africa, Janet Africa, and Janine Africa. This is a night of solidarity, our collective shout to the world to bring our sisters home. This is our chance to once again aid our sister and queen, Ramona Africa, in her advocacy and push for the release of her MOVE family. Another chance and opportunity to keep the legacy, contributions, and sacrifices of those both taken from us and being kept from us, alive and in the forefront of the centuries-old struggle for Black freedom. As John Africa taught us, the power of the truth is indeed powerful. Tonight, we come together to tell, own, and shout to the world our truth. We have the right to be here. Ashe.
Ashe.
Peace, love, and light to you all, and thank you again. Peace.
While the family is up in this house and revolution is being spoken in poetry and every kind of thing, well, the next person coming up here needs no introduction, but I'm gonna give him one anyway. This brother is James McIntosh from CEMOTAP. And this is a frontline revolutionary brother, and who has been down to Philadelphia a lot of times for MOVE, for MOMIA. And I taught him a few things. I taught him about the megabus. Yes, he didn't know about that. He didn't know about the Chinatown bus. Yeah, so I give him great information. But this brother, I'm telling you, he is always there for us. We have been up to CEMOTAP, most programs that they have. We've been to the house of...
John Henry Clark.
Yes, Brother John Henry Clark's house, and are on speaking engagements for MOVE, for MOMIA, and are for political prisoners. This brother's just a round-the-clock black man. On the move, brother. And are John McIntosh from CEMOTAP and a whole lot of other things that I can't don't know of, but I know CEMOTAP.
On the move!
On the move!
Free to move nine!
Free
all our political prisoners! Free them all! I'm here on behalf. First, let me thank all of the organizers for tonight's event. Let me thank the Minister of Confrontation, Sister Pam Africa, for inviting me in that introduction. And I'm just here to say that CEMOTAP, the Committee to Eliminate Media Offensive to African People, is 100% in solidarity with the call and the demand to free our political prisoners and to free to move nine. We are also 100% in support of the tactical move to call for the parole of the move nine. I mean, they should be free. But since we don't have state power, and we don't have the military power to bust them out and keep them out, we'll settle for parole. You don't have to be a revolutionary to be for parole for the Move Nine. You don't have to be a revolutionary. I mean, it sickens my stomach to think of the Move Nine having to report to a parole officer. It sickens my stomach for me to think of them having to say they will abide by the corrupt laws of this corrupt government, whatever else they have to do to be on parole. But not as much as it sickens my stomach to think of them in those dangerous, nasty dungeons that they've been in for the last 38 years. Not as much as it sickens me to think about them staying in there for 20 or more years. Not as much as it sickens me to think of them perhaps even dying behind those walls. No, I take parole every day of the week for the Move Nine and for all our political prisoners rather than that. Parole is nothing revolutionary. There's people who are not fit to kiss the feet of the Move Nine that have been given parole. Some of them don't even have to get parole. Justin Volpe, you ever heard that name? That's the man who tortured Abner Louima. They gave him a sentence of 30 years with no parole. That's a trick, because that means in 30 years they got to let him out. You see? He's already gotten married down there in Florida, and not to that little knucklehead that was talking about the black woman that said she was his girlfriend. Not, she went down there to Florida, he married a white woman, okay? Justin Volpe, all right? They're letting him out in 9 years. He's going to be walking out of here on the street, having served 8 years less than the Move Nine has already served. There's a woman, Sarah Moore. She busted two caps at the President of the United States. Two, shot twice. Hit a innocent bystander, got to court. They asked her, "Are you sorry?" These are almost her exact words. She said, "I regret I didn't succeed." She said, "Our purpose was to create chaos." In 1987 or so, not 1987, a couple of years after that, she escaped. Guess what happened? In about 32 years, she got parole. The Move Nine been down 38 years. This guy, Messer, shot Oscar Grant. He served less time than Michael Vick served for killing a dog. Less than 2 years. Squeaky Frome. Y'all heard that name before. She shot it at President Ford. Got to court, took an apple, threw it and hit the DA in the face, knocked his glasses off. In 1987, she escaped for 2 days. 22 years after that escape.
They let out on parole. This is nothing revolutionary. This is something that's supposed to happen to you when you get corrected. The Move 9 didn't need any correcting. They were eating right. They were exercising. They were having their babies. They were preaching life. They were confronting injustice. They didn't need any correcting. But certainly, 38 years, they got to be correct if Squeaky Frome is correct in 22 after trying to escape. So my point is that CMOTAP, the Committee to Eliminate Media Offensive to African People, is down with this tactical decision to call for parole. We're here to do whatever it is that you need us to do to call for parole, because this is nothing revolutionary. Now you might say, why did they send me? I'm only speaking on behalf of my organization, CMOTAP. Why'd they send me in this suit? A black suit. I'm gonna tell you why. There's a reason. This is not an accident. They sent me here to show the strength of our coalition. Not only do we have masked up revolutionaries, dreadlock revolutionaries, dashiki wearing revolutionaries, we got respectable, suited, and tied up Negroes like myself with all the bourgeois credentials. A job, an MD degree, a haircut. So listen, ain't nothing to be scared of. Everybody joining on this movement. We want freedom for the Move 9. We want parole for the Move 9. Free them all! Free them all! Free them all! Thank you.
Woo! The man in the suit. Wow. Okay. Our next person, where's she at with a little self? We'll be speaking about what's happening with Mumia Abu-Jamal. And if I can get someone to pass out the cards and the petition cards for the sign for the governor for Mumia, and Suzanne will bring you up to date with what's happening. Following Suzanne will be Sister Johanna Fernandez speaking on the Move Women as well, and followed by a concert that is going to be put on by the Move Youth and other folks that's here. So I'm saying, this is revolution by any means necessary. Suzanne, and it is a pleasure working with you, my sister, throughout the years. And she's a reminder. She stays on top of things. And and we just love her. And Sister Suzanne Ross, and of the New York Coalition, and the brothers and sisters from the New York Coalition and the Campaign to Free Mumia, and could you stand up and wave your hands? All right, all right. On the move, Suzanne Ross.
On the move. I really want to start by paying all honors and dues to Pam Africa, Ramona Africa, and the Move organization. And the tribute is, it took a long time for people to understand the level of horrendous attack, viciousness, and genocidal strategy that was waged against Move. But it took even longer, at least another decade or two, for people to understand the kind of contribution that Move has made and can make to our consciousness. There has never, I think to this day, there hasn't been adequate understanding of what their contribution has been. And so before I say a little bit about what the Free Mumia Abu-Jamal Coalition is doing and what's happening in the movement, I want to mention a couple of things that are really important to highlight. But I just remembered what I wanted to start with. Please, a moment of applause and tribute to our fallen brother, Sundiata Sadiq, who passed just a week ago. Presidente! So we all feel the loss of the brother, and we want to note, a lot of people have been asking me, and we've been getting messages from all over the world. There was a Muslim burial for him a week ago, but on the 21st of May, there will be a memorial tribute to him right here in New York City. Please put that on your calendar. It's almost 95% definite, but we'll keep you posted. But for those of you who ask, let's remember Sundiata, the example. He loved MOVE loved Sundiata. And he was supposed to be going on a delegation with us to Saint Denis, France, next month. Okay, going back. The lessons and the importance of what MOVE teaches us, I think, is worth highlighting again and again and again. Number one, of course, their consistency, lasting as long as they have. Number two, and this has been talked about a lot, the love they show for the people, the love, the revolutionary love they infuse the movement with, a culture and a value system, and the kind of way of dealing with people that unfortunately has not been as widespread as it should be. We look to them for that kind of leadership. Three, they're smart and strategic. I don't know how many of you remember the big custody case that went on years back. People had all kinds of advice. Take the little boy to Cuba, run away, do this, do that. First thing they did was barricade their houses so that they could show the state how serious they were. The houses were barricaded. People said they're extreme, they're getting crazy, nobody's attacking. They knew that they could be attacked. That's the first thing they did. The second thing they did is they prepared brilliantly for court. And you know what? They won. That child was never separated from his mother, not for one day. How many of you know of custody cases like that? And these were revolutionaries coming in with dreadlocks, with everybody knew their ways of raising children were different. They won, hands down. And it was the kind of thinking and strategizing that we all need to learn from. Number four, whatever number I'm up to. And this was talked about, I'm trying to remember who talked about it earlier, but it was talked about it before, but I want to highlight it again. Unity. Nobody I have ever seen other than the Vietnamese and their revolution has shown the kind of brilliance in building unity as MOVE has. How do you think a movement to free Mumia has lasted all these years and all these decades? With the range of people that were part of that, black nationalists, Marxist-Leninists, racists even, all kinds of people who had narrow perspectives on many questions, but were willing to fight for Mumia's freedom, or at least for his getting a new trial. And Pam and the other MOVE members consistently fought to keep that unity together in the movement. That movement to free Mumia has been built by MOVE. That movement is an example of a winning strategy, not complete victory, but a victory that has been impressive nonetheless. I won't highlight all the victories that have been stage victories. So that's something that we have to really learn from. Oh, how do they do it? I could give you examples for hours on how they kept things together at key moments when it could have easily fallen apart. And that's true for the ideology and the practice of MOVE. And finally, they're internationalists. They travel all over the world, have traveled all over the world. They've supported struggles from Puerto Rico to Africa to Cuba, all over the world. And they are loved and known all over the world. I've been in many places where I've been shocked at how many people knew about MOVE and loved them. From northern Italy to Venezuela to Algeria, these are some of the places where I've been and I've seen that kind of love. So, long live John Africa.
Long live
the MOVE organization. And on the MOVE. And right now we're on the MOVE to free Mumia as well as the MOVE 9. So, you've all heard real quick, you've all heard that Mumia was very, very ill and nearly died in March of this past year, that the Bureau of the Department of Corrections of Pennsylvania had completely botched up and nearly killed him intentionally or not so intentionally, whatever it was. We know that they've been out to kill Mumia since the very beginning, and this sure looked like a new version of an attempt at killing him. And they almost succeeded. You've seen those pictures where he looked like he was not going to make it. Many of us were very, very nervous. In the process, we were able to bring in a brilliant African-American doctor who had worked for Doctors Without Borders and who was smart enough, even just seeing Mumia in the waiting room, because he was not allowed to see him in a private, as a doctor, as an official doctor, they wouldn't let him do that. But even visiting him in the visiting room, he was able to diagnose that Mumia was suffering from hepatitis C, something that the people at the Department of Corrections, after spending $170,000 on tests and tests and tests, were not able to diagnose, and to this day haven't diagnosed him. But we are now on the battle to get treatment for him and have discovered in the process that hepatitis C is extremely widespread all over the prisons, all over Pennsylvania, 46,000 people in Philadelphia alone, about 10,000 people infected with hepatitis C in the prisons of Pennsylvania. And like with the death warrant and the death penalty, when Mumia's case became a calling cry against the death penalty all over the United States, people hardly paid attention to the death penalty until Mumia began writing about what it was like. Well, this is hepatitis C. Once again, Mumia has made an issue out of something that was secret and a horrible secret that is killing thousands of people. So there's now a campaign to get Mumia the treatment he needs and to get all the people in the prisons of Pennsylvania, in the cities all over Pennsylvania and all over this country, the kind of treatment which is available at a high cost, but we're demanding that the cost be lowered, because it has been in countries like Egypt and India. It's completely possible, even though they're now charging $1,000 a pill for a 90-day, 90-pill regimen. So, there are cards over on that table. Gil, would you raise your hand, please? Gwen is giving out cards. This is letters to the governor of Pennsylvania to get this treatment going immediately. And there will be actions and more happening around April 24th. We're going to be gathering on April 20th, Friday, right before Mumia's birthday in Philadelphia. Tune in for everything that's happening. And once again, free them all!
Free them all! On the MOVE. I've been nudged and pushed and shoved by the warrior woman, Sister Betty Davis, and a lot of people, and ought to say, it's time to make a collection. And also, could people kindly and all reach into your pockets and pull out honestly whatever you can to support this effort? It's a lot of work and are getting out a lot of information. And one of the things that what we're doing with selling food at this particular time is that we're raising monies, and because my brother, my brother Mike has come up with the idea and the other youth of building a MOVE school. So that's why we're now in the process of raising funds to make the idea a reality. So we're asking people to help us and be generous as you can. Put somebody on the door. Sister Betty Davis said put somebody on the door. And also, the book. This is a limited edition. We only have about 10 of these books, so we figured out how to best raise money. We're not selling these books. This is a raffle for $1. And this is 25 years on the move, and it tells you about our belief. It tells you about the confrontation, who's been involved in it. It's only this one book. There's a raffle. Where are the young folks collecting for the raffle? Okay, so they're gonna do the donations first, and then we'll do the raffle for the 25 years on the move book. Okay, that business is done. I'm gonna give people a few minutes, and then I'm gonna have to ask people to please be quiet. Our final speaker for tonight, before we go into the concert, which I know everyone is going to love. Oh, you got something to say, Ralph?
Yes, much to say. As Malcolm would say, if you got $5 for your transportation, give it up. Put it in the pot. We need the money. Just continue to dig deeper. We want all the money you have, the money you save for next week. Put it in the pot. We want to leave here not with dollars. We want to leave here with thousands of dollars.
Whoa.
Let's reach in our pocket deep. Now, you all know, for the last 10 years, I've been begging you for support to get Sister Lynn out. And I can put something in the pot. I'm going to beg you some more. And I don't have any money. I already put some in, but I'm going to go deeper. I'm going to go for $50. And God knows I don't have it. We have another 50 out there. We have another 50, Betty. Let's match it. Let's bring it out. Let's get out. Do we believe it?
Here
we got
another
one.
We got enough money in this
house
for you all.
I want $1,000.
Come on,
man. Come on, let's get our dollars out there. I'm going to beg some other people to make this 50 up. Come on, folks.
Come on, man.
I want to see them. Dig, dig, dig. How much freedom you up to? Are you up to giving up your money? And this is what it takes. Give it up. Freedom ain't free. Nothing is. Come on, 50. Do I have to go deeper for another 20? Somebody's gonna have to take me home because I don't have enough money to get there. I'm going for another 20. Come on, folks. Reach in your pocket. Get your checkbook out. Here's another 20. Can somebody match that?
There's 250.
Here's 250.
Come
they're,
on.
They're doing it.
Money for Gucci, Kawashi.
Here we go. Here's some more 20s. We're getting 20s here. Come on. Come on. Bring it up. Bring it up. Bring it up. Here we go. Two 20s. Come on. Come on.
Thank you.
Come on up. Here we go.
Thank you, my
here we go. Come on up.
Thank you.
Bring it up. Come on.
Thank you, my sister.
Yes,
thank you.
Two more 20s. Come
thank
on.
You.
Come on. Don't be shy. Give me that check.
These are our brothers and
come
sisters.
On. How
put
much?
Their life on the line.
How much do we love them? Come on.
I love them a lot. For the sacrifice.
All righty. 20, 50s. I love you. Come on.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Here's 100 to move.
Thank
come
you.
On. Come on. Come on. How much you love him? Come on.
It's in
Lynn,
the house.
You got any money?
It's in the house. Come on, y'all.
No, Lynn doesn't have any money. Come on. Bring it up. Bring it up.
Bring it up.
Come on.
Bring
come on. Let's show some love here.
Down,
this ain't enough love. Come on.
On
the checkbook. Come on. Come on. I want to see some love. I want to count some love. Come on. Bring it up. Come on. Don't be shy. Don't be shy. All righty, brother. All righty. More. What's that? I want more.
Quiero más. Come on. Bring the money. Come on. Is that it? Is that it? Not yet. Come on. Come on. Bring it up. Dollars. Quarters. Dimes. Bring it up. All righty. The young are bringing it up. Come on. We got it. Here we are. All righty. I'm going to... If we finish... We finish... Okay, I'm going to walk. You got it. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. All right, moving right along here. Everybody, don't get restless. We got a couple more speakers. Then we got the hip hop show coming up too. Hip hop for the Move 9. All right, our next speaker, where's the sister at? Live from Baruch College and the coordinator of the campaign to bring Momia home. We give y'all Sister Johanna Fernandez. Put it together, y'all.
Also the author of several books and a documentary film called Justice on Trial. And we do have the book on the brother's table over there called The Writings on the Wall. On the Move, Johanna Harris.
Okay, I know we've been riled up, and we definitely need the funds.
Everybody.
One moment, please.
They have the money, they have the organization, and if we're gonna free the Move 9, if we're gonna bring all our political prisoners home, and if we are gonna mount a revolution in this country, we need money and we need organization. I just wanna say that NPR on May 20th, 2015, covered the Move organization and the Move bombing. And the question raised by NPR was, why have so many people never heard of the Move bombing? And I think that we who are here, the people of conscience who know this story, have a responsibility at this particular moment to answer that question and to make sure that everyone in this city, that everyone in Philadelphia, everyone in this country, and everyone around the world knows the Move bombing. The reason why we do not know about the Move bombing is because with the Move bombing and with the treatment of the Move organization, we see a human rights atrocity in this nation of epic proportion. We did, or the government of this nation did, to the Move people, what we do to the Palestinians, what we did to the Iraqis, what we did to the Afghanis. We bombed them, we disregarded their life, we disregarded their humanity. In this nation, we only do that. The government only does that in such horrific a way to black people who dare to resist and stand against what this system represents. I want to start out, I'm going to be talking about Janet, Janine, and Debbie today. And I want to talk about Janet, Janine, and Deb because we rarely hear about women political prisoners. I also think that as we read the story of the Move organization, because of all of the human rights atrocities behind them, we are empowered to fight. So I want to give you a sense of who these women are and why they joined the Move organization. Because if we're going to defend them, we need to know their stories, and we need to tell their stories from a mountaintop. This is what Janet Holloway, Africa, said about her politicization. and why she joined the MOVE organization. A young woman, African American, this is what she says. I can't even put into words the feeling I got hearing John Africa's teachings. It gripped me in a way that I've never, never been gripped before. For the first time in my life, I felt there was hope for me, and there was reasons why I was so detached, so dissatisfied, and so unhappy. What we know is that MOVE was persecuted and continues to be persecuted because of its fierce philosophical, political, and spiritual defense of life. That which the system of capitalism has absolutely no regard for. This system feared MOVE's defense of the water. An issue that is with us today and that we see in Flint, Michigan. And MOVE was talking about the water in the 1970s before talking about the water and the environment was trendy in American society. This system feared MOVE for its defense of the water, for its defense of the environment, for its defense of the earth, the food we eat, all issues that are very alive and well and part of public discourse today, which tells us that MOVE in the 1970s was ahead of its time. MOVE was feared because of its defense of the life source, which MOVE believes to be mama. This mama, MOVE's believe is the purveyor of the life source, and for that MOVE was attacked. MOVE in the 1970s, at the end of that age of great dreams, was a symbol of resistance and a terrible black threat to the status quo. It was a threat that in the imagination of authority had to be silenced. I want to talk a little bit about Janet Africa, because we need to know the stories of these powerful MOVE women. On May 9th, 1974, Janet and fellow MOVE sister Leasing Africa were walking to the store. They were accosted by cops who quickly became abusive against these women. Both Janet and Leasing were pregnant. The police slammed Janet stomach first against the police car. Both their children, the child of Janet and Leasing, were killed by the police through miscarriage. They both lost their children that night as a result of an encounter with the police through miscarriage. Now I want to talk about Janine Phillips Africa and about why she joined the MOVE organization. She said that at the age of 17, she was overwhelmed because she had a baby. And we know the experience of black poor women in this country with children. Janine was one of those young women at 17, and this is what she said, quote, "I didn't know how to be a mother or a wife, and trying to be both was driving me to a nervous breakdown. I developed a condition where my throat would close up on me and I couldn't eat. I went from doctor to doctor, hospital to hospital, and none of them could do anything for me," unquote. She found love, refuge, righteous struggle, family, and collective childcare in the MOVE organization. And her condition, the fact that her throat had closed up and no one could tell her why, no doctor, was resolved. Because she found in MOVE community and an antidote to her alienation, a reason to struggle for black people, for all people, and for freedom in these United States and in the world. As the repression against MOVE was mounting, in the 1970s, 10 police cars descended on the MOVE house and attacked 7 MOVE members who had just been released from prison. Janine stepped in to defend her valiant husband, the late Philip Africa, Phil Africa, who was recently killed by the state. The cops threw Janine to the ground, even though she was carrying her three-week-old daughter, Life Africa. She was carrying Life Africa in her arms. Life Africa was killed on that day by the police. Immediately, the MOVE organization held a press conference the next day. Officials denied the killing of Life Africa because Life was born in the MOVE house and didn't have a birth certificate. So the MOVE organization strategically did what it has been doing for the last 40 years. It invited local politicians to their house, the MOVE house, the sanctity of that house and the sanctity of Life, to view the body of Life Africa, and the media had to report on it. I want to now talk about Debbie Sims Africa. She tells a compelling story about the day the MOVE house was attacked and destroyed by the city of Philadelphia on August 18, 1978. And all of these atrocities are happening before the actual bombing of the MOVE house in 1985. This is what she says about that day that the MOVE house was under siege by the city of Philadelphia. She was in the house with her 23-month-old, and she was 8.5 weeks pregnant with Mike Africa, who's with us today. The pressure, she says, of the fire hoses used by the firemen to drown out the house was so fierce, I'm quoting her now, that it threw the 2x4 oak beams of the window across the room, slamming our big dogs up against the wall and literally tearing the house apart from the inside. Then a second wave of water came through another would-be window, and we were caught in a crossfire of water. When the cops started shooting, I closed my eyes and just held tight to my stomach and protectively shielded my baby. The smoke bombs and tear gas were choking us. All the while, the water level was rising. We found out later during our trial from one of the lawyers appointed to represent us that when a mixture of smoke and water are thrown together, it acts as a deadly weapon and could have suffocated all of us. I personally thought we were going to die. It was only a miracle that we didn't die. Within a year or so, she had Mike Africa in prison, naturally, on her own, alone in prison. She held Mike Africa for 7 hours and then faced the inevitable that Mike, her son, would have to be taken from her. And this is what happens to women and black women disproportionately in this nation, day in and day out, in a nation where the incarceration of black women is growing at 800%, the fastest growth in the nation. I think it's important for us to say that behind MOVE, there's a long history of repression against radicals and revolutionaries. But there's also a
that behind MOVE, there's a long history of repression against radicals and revolutionaries. But there's also a long history of survival, challenge to the system, and victory. Behind the MOVE organization, we see Nat Turner, Denmark Veazey, Gabriel Prosser, John Brown, Eugene Debs, the Haymarket Martyrs, Sacco Vanzetti, Ethel and Julius Rosenberg, Angela Davis,
Luis Rodriguez,
Mike,
Leonard Peltier,
Africa,
Sudi
David,
Phil
Gilbert, Sekou Odinga,
Mumia Abu-Jamal. Did I mention Oscar Lopez, Bradley Manning? These are political prisoners, people who are responsible for civilizing American society. All of this tells us that we really stand on the shoulders of giants, and our responsibility, the moral assignment of our generation, is to bring our brothers and sisters home.
And when Mumia comes home, the MOVE 9 will come home, and the whole apparatus of this system, its very logic, will come tumbling down. Free the MOVE 9, free the MOVE women, and onward to a completely different society.
Excellent. I wish we had time for more, but we have to be out of here by 10:15, so we're moving things pretty fast. And I was just told by Ori's sister Ann Lamb, who works with people from New York, she has a quick solidarity statement, and people are going to throw their fists up when they come up, so that we can keep the program moving, because the MOVE Youth had put together a spectacular show for people, and we have other activists, Brother Zaid Muhammad, who's going to do poetry, and we're asking people, please stay, because they all worked very hard to put this program on for you. So I'm asking people to be very short and brief, right now. So if you can stay, please stay. On the MOVE.
All right, I will be very brief because I know that we have time factors. I'm wearing this hat because the MOVE women made me this hat. I've met them twice. I visited them in prison. I'd love to go see them again. It's a little difficult in Pennsylvania. You got to be on a list. They made me two hats. My former roommate has one, and I have this one. And so I'm wearing it now just because it feels good. I work with the Jericho Movement. We do work for all U.S.-held political prisoners and prisoners of war. We've been founded by political prisoners. One of our founders is Jaleel Muntakim. He's been in prison for 45 years, okay? He's coming up for parole in June. Robert Seth Hayes has been in prison for 43 years. He's coming up for parole in June. Herman Bell has been in prison for 43 years. He's coming up for parole in March. Abdul Majid is going to the board for the first time. He's been in prison for more than 33 years because his minimum was 33 and a half. So we have a lot of people. There's another brother going to the board, but somebody is going to speak about that. We have a lot of people going to the parole board for the umpteenth time. And I would like everybody to write letters and sign petitions. You can go online and sign petitions. You can go to jerichony.org and sign petitions. You can write a letter. As Dr. McIntosh said, ain't no big deal to do that. People have made major sacrifices for us. I am disgusted and sick and tired of murderers and thugs calling my friends murderers and thugs. So let's get together and bring them all home, everybody, now, this year. Enough is enough. Free them all.
Good evening, folks. I'm here on behalf of Leonard Peltier. Most of you know. Thank you. Most of you know Leonard has been in prison for 40 years. He's 71 years old. He's been in ill health for many years, but he now has a crisis. He has an abdominal aortic aneurysm. It's like walking around with a time bomb inside your body. You know what the prison medical care is like? They don't want to operate until it gets a little bit bigger. So we've got to contact Obama. Obama might be Leonard's last hope. We have letters over at our table to sign. We have this postcard. Our committee wants to collect all the postcards from all around the chapters and send them to Obama at once. So if you have a minute, please come over, sign the postcard. Thank you. And I think we should give Ori a big hand for organizing this wonderful evening.
I really appreciate Ori in particular, the MOVE family, the MOVE extended family, for thinking of Maliki Shakur Lateen, inviting me to speak on behalf of Maliki Shakur Lateen. If you're not familiar with him or not familiar with his story, it's a great time to learn about him. Thank you. You can go to justiceformaliki.org. You can read about his story. He's former Nation of Islam. He's former Bronx chapter of the Black Panther Party. He ran into a situation with police, a police-involved shooting, like so many black youth have. He's a political prisoner. He's been up for parole six times, denied six times, in for 35 years. He's in parole. He's up for parole in April. There's a major push to get him out. Yeah. There's a decision on his Article 78 in March 11th. We're asking for parole letters by the end of this month. By the end of February, we want people to write parole letters for Maliki Shakur Lateen. All the information will be posted at justiceformaliki.org, Justice for Maliki on Facebook, or at Justice for MSL on Twitter. Thanks so much for having me. Thank you. Free them all.
Okay, I guess I'm rounding us out. Hey, you guys, my name is Jerry Coach. I'm from New York City Anarchist Black Cross. We do political prisoner support for political prisoners and prisoners of war held in the U.S. At the moment, there's 65 of them by our count. We've got a table in the back. We've got trifolds on pretty much everyone we support. We also have ways to write them. We have an illustrated guide to everyone. We do letter writing nights twice a month in Bushwick, Brooklyn, 1302 Myrtle. Free food, free postage, free everything. We just chat about some political prisoners and ask that you just write a thoughtful letter. We highly encourage you to come check it out. Other than that, we also put on a number of events, as well as putting money on people's books and doing whatever other support. Indeed, I will keep it brief. Okay, we're having Mark Cook on the 20th. Many of you may know him. He's a good friend. Former George Jackson Brigade, former political prisoner, an amazing individual. On the 20th, that's next Saturday, at Bushwick, Brooklyn, at the base. We have a bunch of pamphlets back there and flyers and everything else that's paper that you should take with you. I will close with fuck the police and burn all the prisons to the ground. Thank you.
All right. That time. We get into the hip hop show part now, so don't go nowhere. Coming. Okay, wait, we're gonna do the raffle. Everybody got their tickets ready? It's raffle time, don't get restless. We got the hip hop show coming. You got the they win a copy, a vintage copy of 25 Years on the Move. Who got the ticket? You ready to read off the ticket, Mona? All right, we're gonna get to the raffle. Y'all get your tickets ready.
People don't wanna buy a ticket.
Read the rim and winning number.
The winning ticket is 5, 1, 4, 8, 9, 7, 1.
Say it again,
Brianna. 5.
All right, winner.
Where's the winner?
Right here.
Right here?
Yep.
Go see Mona, hey. Brother. Everybody, you ready? It's time for the hip hop show.
Yeah.
Where my sister at? I met this sister in the streets of Brooklyn years ago, always seeing her flyers, information out. It's one of our surprise artists who graced us with her presence tonight. I bring to y'all from Legal Eagles, the CEO of Starface Entertainment. Let's put it together, y'all, for Sister Elsie Law.
It's an honor to be here before you today. The piece we're going to do is called the All. I hope the sound is all right. Yeah. Produced by my husband, first of all. So the off the sheet, lyrics off the sheet, there's blood on your teeth and mud on our cleats. All that nonviolence had us under attack. When a player backfires, starts firing back. What's your point? Choice of weapon, a gun or a drum? I hit him with some Machiavelli 101. Lord knows I say those pilgrims, they'll be down. Only snakes live their lives with their bellies on the ground. Paradise destroyers, I call them apple biters. I see cowards and sparrers, but not enough fighters. Yet there's so much violence, I can see it's a trap. It's not conspiracy theory, it's conspiracy fact. Since when we start birthing bipolar bisexuals and starting revolutions with Google search intellectuals, can't look outside yourself if you want to be free. That's why their president is black and my president is me. Like Ida, Garvey, Malcolm and Paul, we have to fight back. They can't kill us all like the Sada, Tupac, Mutulu Shakur. We have to fight back. They can't kill us all like Ida, Garvey, Malcolm and Paul. We have to fight back. They can't kill us all like the Sada, Tupac, Mutulu Shakur. We have to fight back. They can't kill us all. Pimps in the pulpit, epitomize hypocrisy. We live in a country where demons mock democracy. A pig will shoot you down over pigmentation. Cooning and soft shoeing gets standing ovations. Being a spoonful of sugar away from being Cisco. The only way to get a corporate job from these Nabiscos. Wear some Afro puffs, they think you in a rage. It's how it grows out my head. I'm not going through a stage of black people lost or taking the scenic routes. Hands in the air, begging pigs not to shoot. You expect mercy from a mercenary? You hit your heart, you better go and find that in a hurry. Black people calling other black people racist to prove they non-threatening around white faces. Political prisoners, convicted for convictions, made to look like villains in all media depictions. Like Ida, Garvey, Malcolm and Paul, we have to fight back. They can't kill us all like Ashada, Tupac, Mutulu Shakur. We have to fight back. They can't kill us all like Ida, Garvey, Malcolm and Paul. We have to fight back. They can't kill us all like Ashada, Tupac, Mutulu Shakur. We have to fight back. They can't kill us all. Thank you.
Okay, the next person that's gonna, revolutionary poet, Brother Zain Muhammad, and to New York there's no, he needs no introduction, but this is a revolutionary poet. Met him in the late 80s, going into the 90s, might have been before then, and this brother is awesome.
Say we're gonna run on, see what the end is gonna bring. Say we're gonna run on, see what the end is gonna bring. Say we're gonna run on, see what the end is gonna bring. Say we're gonna run on, see what the end is gonna bring. When the time has come, move. Once you get clear, move. Once you get ready, move. Once you get set, move. Once the light comes on, move. Once the toxic smoke clears, move. Once the truth arrives, sledgehammer hard and heavy, move. Once you had enough, move. Once you've done your work, move. Once the children and elders are secure, move. Once your allies are with you, move. Once the spirit of justice stirs like hot stew, move. Once you're down, get up, move. When the word is given, when the drum sounds, when the time comes for the precious air we shed, for the water for our tongue and skin, get ready, get set, for love, for liberation, for life. Move, 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 God damn it, move. Say we're gonna run on.
You know, one name I haven't heard raised in here tonight, Brother Jamil Alameen. And we must remember Brother Jamil Alameen. He was moved from Pennsylvania. He's now in Arizona. And look up, because I don't have paperwork with me. And but he need cards. He need people to let these people on the inside know we got his back. And we got more than that. We 360 surrounding that brother. Another person who hadn't been mentioned tonight is Dr. Safia Siddiqui, Palestinian in prison, who was arrested with her three children. Look up, Pakistani, what did I say? Oh, okay, all right. See, we get by with the help from our family. That's right. When one of us mess up, there's another one to straighten it out. I love you, brother. The Pakistani, please look up Sister Safia Siddiqui. And on March 15th, at the UAM Automatics fundraiser for the children for the summer, Dick Gregory will be performing. Mark that down on your calendars, okay? And it's so many people in here that, you know, I want to call your names, but it's too many to do right now. I don't want to call somebody's name and be the forgotten, didn't call somebody else. But family, we are, and the people united will never be defeated. I'm saying, I might not remember your names, but the motherfuckers that's watching us know you here, know you strong, and know you on the move. So, with that being said, I'd like to bring up Debbie Africa's son, and Mike Africa's son, because we introduced earlier the youth of other political prisoners. So Mike Africa and your family, come up, Mike and Debbie. Oh, Mike, Ramona was reminding me to let y'all know that Mike Africa is the baby that was in Debbie's stomach when we were attacked in 1978 by the Rizzo administration, when they threw bombs in, and she was talking about the smoke and the things, and you know, the shooting, the ducking of bullets, and the fact that John Africa brought every last MOVE member out alive, men, women, and children, and the ones that was in the womb. Mike evidence that Mike Africa is evidence of a miracle. And his sister also, Michelle, who was in the house, and I believe Michelle was the baby. If you ever saw the August 8th tape, and when them stinking, rotten ass cops grabbed Debbie's baby from her arms and was carried by the feet with the head down, carried it like this and carried it like this and handed her over and all to another police officer. So, you know, on the move, could y'all come up, and then we'll have all the other children and family members a move at the very end. So, Mike Africa. Where's Michelle?
On the move. Long live John Africa. I'm gonna say long, but I know we ain't got a lot of time. But I just want to reflect this time right now to look at our people. Our people has been growing. We're getting stronger and stronger every day, stronger in our commitment, more dedicated to the teaching of John Africa, and that's what the system feared. And we gotta keep it moving. Everybody, we gotta keep it moving. Don't stop moving. That's it.
I just want to say thank you for everybody for coming out, and on the move, and long live John Africa.
Just talk, don't touch it.
No, we gotta take them apart. We need two mics for the performances.
Oh, you need a mic, that mic.
Don't take that, no.
All right, you wanna use that? Use the mic.
No, but that's what you're expensive. It's going to be
just
too hot.
Just take the recording for us. This is for the house.
Okay. All right. Okay. Is that it? All right.
Yep.
One move, long way behind.
So right now, some of the MOVE youth are going to come up here. R-A-W, RAW, MOVE youth. Lady, you coming up next? Alright, MOVE youth is going to come up and do some political hip-hop for you guys and let you know what MOVE is still here today fighting for life, justice, the release of all political prisoners, and they're going to do a rap for you, basically explaining to you about the corruption that goes on in the system, and this is MOVE youth here, so as soon as the music come on, we'll hear some music from them. It's also their New York debut, so give them a round of applause.
Sandra Bland and Mike Brown, the man that shot him down, be bound and found. And made it sound trial, but the families of the victim, not the KKK, who making money off the lynching.
Just for the move, not sitting in jail. We need a freedom tonight before the cops in the cell. We need a freedom. The bomb for the cops, that's what the bomb for the cops. Christians need to stop and no visa. And we show only more stuff. We need to eat less bacon. The word about to help.
The whole system is a failure. Look at the way it is.
All these big business, broken politicians need a life in prison sentence for the crime they commit.
next is R.A.W. R.A.W., More Move You.
More Move. When it's clear that the enemy is industry, cause this enemy is pumping out pollution, and this industry that ain't got the solution. Who's been telling people over 40 years now that that system is the cause for your tears now, and the cause for your horrors and your fears now? And all the crazy things that you always hear about are finding solutions with the internet, right? Because who's got solutions that'll make us insane? It's insane not to resist this pain, and the system pump pain like a drug in your vein. We ain't crazy, the system's crazy. We ain't crazy, the president's crazy. We ain't crazy, the cops is crazy. We ain't crazy, they crazy. We ain't crazy, the system's crazy. We ain't crazy, the president's crazy. We ain't crazy, the cops is crazy. We ain't crazy, they crazy. Anybody, 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 not paying attention. Thank God, they got the regard of you, real shit, the bomb on the killing and torturing, crucifying and aborting, and people treating us like we're a problem for the earth, but crazy. We ain't crazy, the president's crazy. We ain't crazy, the cops is crazy. We ain't crazy, they crazy. The system's crazy. We ain't crazy, the president's crazy. We ain't crazy, the cops is crazy. We ain't crazy, they crazy. Bother enough. Saying things like who kids. People graduated college, they still stupid. So they can say what they want. I'ma survive like a child. Fight back, you who's sleeping on that. That's why they lie. When they drop a bomb on us, cause the news say we crazy, but we ain't crazy, the system's crazy. We ain't crazy, the president's crazy. We ain't crazy, the cops is crazy. We ain't crazy, they crazy. We ain't crazy, the system's crazy. We ain't crazy, the president's crazy. We ain't crazy, the cops is crazy. We ain't crazy, they crazy. On the move, long live John Africa.
And also want to remind you that there's going to be a march on February 20th for Malcolm X, and a demonstration, a march at 125th Street and Clayton Powell for 7th. So asking people to get your signs together, get your props and bang. Let's make some noise, let the Klan know we're still here, still strong. Ain't gonna ever let them forget what they did to Malcolm. Ain't gonna ever let them forget what Malcolm had done for all of us. So, the next person coming up is Elsie the Poet, and then followed by my sister Ramona Africa.
What's up, y'all? My name is Elsie the Poet, aka Nefertiti. You know what I'm saying? Can't do my thing. What's up this life? Check, check, check. Alright, so. Check, check. Got another mic?
Check, check. Check.
Check. Alright, so I.
we don't have to grow. We down one by one, it's like survival of the fittest. There's nothing we can do because politicians never listen. We need to get support because we live in poverty. People getting more living expensive properties. We thirsty for the help and we tired of the struggle. I know you hear me loud and clear, don't ever say I mumble. They treat us like dogs, we stuck up on a leash. Muzzles on our mouths, they don't wanna hear us speak. They talk about amendments but they break them every day. They lurk behind dollar signs and bite us like a snake. Projects, knowledge, in my laboratory. Science doesn't give a shit about my respiratory. Dissecting my spirit for the God they trust. Killing my soul, cause I couldn't keep shut. God is flawless, sending in your story. Perfecting my demons, huh, they did it for me. Yeah, my P's and Q's are their double U's. Yet they so confusing my longitude, altitude. Remains in the acid of rain. Blood shattering your mind, subconscious insane. Reptilian state caused me to be profane. Murder, death at an unstoppable rate. Black power, black knowledge, black hour, black college. Clock is passing while we looking back when crack was born through Lynch's track. I can't breathe, but I never mattered. So now I'm here in this lab with the answers. Peace. Peace.
Next up is a miracle. A miracle walking. In 1985, when the government dropped the bomb, killed 11 men, women, and children, the cops described the situation there where fire and flames was everywhere. And out of those flames, the cops said it was if the flames opened up and out walked Ramona Africa. Brother, Dirty Africa. Because Mona had a message to give. John Africa brought her through that fire. So they took the beat here and are on this level, letting people know where there is hope and there's love and there's trouble and continuation. My sister, one and woman.
Alright, on the move. Long live revolution. That's what we all better be about here. The times are serious and we better be serious. We're being killed in the streets, killed by diseases, killed in these hospitals, killed in these prisons. Things are serious. And we better be serious about putting an end to it. We better be. I want to bring my whole move family up here. I want everybody to come on up. Everybody that performed and didn't perform, everybody, come on up. Come on, y'all. Don't be shy. Ain't no time to be shy. Come on, y'all. On the move. This is the family, the warriors, the disciples of the legendary John Africa. A force that they tried to stop in the early 70s, tried to kill off in August of 1978, tried to kill off again in May of 1985, but as you see, we are still here, still strong, and still fighting to bring this rotten-ass system down. That's the work that we're committed to. Now, We're committed to this work and we ain't gonna stop. We ain't gonna stop even when we bring our family home, which we intend to do, because that doesn't end our work. Our work is not done until this system is felled and put in the dirt of correction. That's the only time our work will be done, and we're committed to it. We all know who we were and what we were before John Africa, before encountering MOVE's belief and getting strong, getting cleaned up, and that's why we're still committed no matter what this system have come at us with. They can't stop John Africa's MOVE organization because they can't stop life. And that's our belief. They ain't got enough cops. They ain't got enough guns. They ain't got enough jails. They ain't got enough bombs, judges, politicians. They ain't got enough to stop John Africa's MOVE organization. No matter what they come at us with, we come back at them that much harder. And we're committed to it because they're the ones that got everything to lose. We have nothing to lose.
That's right.
Nothing to lose. And we know that, and that gives us the advantage. That gives us the advantage, and we know it, and we need it. Ready? In law we trust, all praises to the Lord of light, the power to fight, long live MOVE, long live John Africa, long live John Africa, long live John Africa, long live John Africa, long live John Africa. All right, thank everybody for coming out. I want to thank Johnny Stevens and his live screen crew. I want to thank Dawn, who filmed, this brother here, who filmed. And most importantly, I want to thank Ori, where'd he go? Ori, for bringing all this together. Long live Ori, on the MOVE, and long live revolution.
Everybody, we gotta be out.
Yeah. We're gonna need a little group participation, family. We're supposed to be out here by 10:15. We gotta get these chairs stacked up. We gotta help people pack up. Any cups, anything you see laying around, help us. There's a trash in the back. Thank everybody for coming out. Don't forget the Malcolm X March on the 20th. Oh, and the spoon left, and everybody can get some and take some home, please. All right now, on the MOVE, see you next time. March in Philadelphia for the MOVE.